tall this afternoon. Isaac Byrd tied for second in the conference in receptions. He is the go-to guy, and they meet on the field today. Dr. Pepper and your local Dr. Pepper bottler present the Big 12 Conference Game of the Week. Today from Memorial Stadium in Lawrence, Kansas, the Texas Longhorns take on the Kansas Jayhawks. And it's that time of the year, folks, where this game means something. Texas still has their eyes on the Southern Division title. They need to win out in order to go to St. Louis. Kansas also needs to win their final two games in order to qualify for a possible bowl bid. Hello again, everybody. Along with my broadcast partner, Steve Davis, I'm Ron Thulin. Weather is the big story. It is extremely windy. We are expecting rain. And if it does get bad, Steve, throw out the passing game. They're going to keep it on the ground. And we've got a trio of rushers today that are very good.
Well, we really do. And I think the wind will have a factor. And that means the runners have to really play big today for both teams. The University of Texas has a tandem of runners. Sean Mitchell, last week's 150-yard game, he was superlative in that effort that Texas beat Texas Tech. And then Ricky Williams, the 143 yards. These two guys combined for 293 yards last week. When they're going, this Texas offense moves. June Henley of Kansas, he has a chance. He's the number six rusher in the country. He really has a chance to set the tempo for the University of Kansas. They've got to take pressure off the quarterback and off this defense.
Well, if you think the weather's going to get bad, how important is it to start off fast for either team?
Well, I think that a game like this, and particularly for the University of Kansas, they need to set the tempo. They need something good to happen to really stay in the ball game. I think Texas is the better team athletically, but the thing is, Kansas, if they can get tempo early, then it'll be a ball game.
Well, it's the final home game of the year for the Jayhawks, and they would like to end it on a winning note. It's the Jayhawks and the Longhorns coming your way next. Is blowing extremely hard at Memorial Stadium, but we're set for a football game that means a lot. The Longhorns taking on the Jayhawks from Memorial Stadium. Now let's take a look at the Southwest Airlines team, Steve.
I think it's critical today. The University of Texas has the better talent. They've got to execute. They've struggled throughout the season in terms of putting it all together. Secondly, force the pass. That means shutting off the run and making Kansas pass in this terrible ring. Terrible wind. And then finally, be patient. And for the University of Kansas, if you look at what they've got to do, they need a quick start. They need something good to happen outside of just offense and defense, physical. Do something in the game to play very physically, take it to Texas, and then finally earn bonus points. Figure out a way to make something else, something special happen in the ball game. I think that's going to be key for Kansas.
And it'll be a knockdown drag out. We'll step aside, and when we return, it'll be the kickoff between the Longhorns and the Jayhawks. Stay with us. Still filing in here at Memorial Stadium. It is an overcast day. We are expecting some precipitation as the game goes on. And Jeff McCord's kick, courtesy of that 40-plus mile-an-hour wind, splits the uprights. And Texas will begin first and 10 from their own 20 as we look at James Brown, the junior out of Beaumont, Texas. He has had an up-and-down year, but as of late, coaches have felt maybe he's becoming a little more consistent. And Steve, isn't it a case for James Brown that he's trying to force things a little bit?
I think early in the season, because he missed spring practice and a lot of the preseason drills, they really felt like he was pressing, trying to make something happen. He's really relaxed. He's let the rest of his team kind of come around him and surround him, and he's played much better in the last 5 weeks.
Well, one thing this Texas offense needs to be more of, and that is patient. Mitchell and Williams are in the backfield. And they're going to keep it on the ground to Ricky Williams. He's going to try the right side, and a bunch of blue jerseys stop him after a pickup of three. Patrick Brown on the hip. Let's take a look at the lineup, first of all, for the University of Texas.
Well, the offensive line of Texas, there are some young players in that line, but Dan Neal, number 69, is really the star player of that front line of Texas. And then in the running back, John Mitchell and Ricky Williams, two big stories there. And then Mike Adams, a prolific receiver for the University of Texas. He's a big play guy.
Second down and six. The pickup was officially four. Texas going right into the teeth of the wind. Crossing the 25, it is Sean Mitchell as we take a look at the defense for the University of Kansas.
in talking to the defensive coaches, that front line, Houston, McGraw, and Cope have to play exceptionally well against this big physical line. And then the secondary, the linebackers, Patrick Brown, Thorin, Ward, Warner, and Jones will share responsibilities there at the outside backer. And then this secondary, watch Mo Gaddy, number 24, and Tony Blevins. They'll have to be big players in this style of play against Texas.
Five defensive backs in for Kansas. Brown from the shotgun. Great drop, has some time, pass is incomplete. Intended for Mike Adams, their leading receiver, who has hauled down 41 receptions this year. Jason Harris on the coverage.
And this is exactly what Kansas need. They got the wind to their back. They need to set the tempo with their defense, make something happen. They're going to get great field position early in the ball game. This is what they need to make a big play, a big statement in this football game.
Isaac Byrd set to receive the kick. This is the top return team, punt return team in the Big 12 and also in the NCAA. Schultes to kick into the wind, and he gets it high, and it's just going to hang up. Byrd calls the fair catch, and Kansas will begin their first offensive possession, first and 10 on their own 42. And we have a Texas player down as we look at Matt Johnner. Johnner taking over for Ben Roots. Roots separated his shoulder. He is out for the year. How about the difference between Roots and Johnner, Steve?
Well, Roots was the more mobile, the guy that really played prolific against Iowa State. When Matt Johnner's in the ball game, he's more analytical, more methodical. They're going to try to move him around, get him away from pressure, give him a chance to have more success at the quarterback position. Kansas cannot put the game in Matt Johnner's hand and expect to win it. They've got to get help. The offensive line, somebody, June Henley, a receiver, somebody's got to play exceptional today.
Well, when Roots was hurt last week, they felt that the coaches felt the offense may have lost a little confidence in what was happening. Now, Johnner steps in. He has to try to regain that confidence here early on. Johnner's first pass, the southpaw completes it up over the 50 into Texas territory. It is Mark Sanders coming out of the backfield. That is his third reception of the year as we take a look at the offensive or defensive line for
Whoops.
Well, we'll try that again. We'll tell you about the defense.
They did a good job. They did a really good job, that defensive line.
Yeah, they did a great job. They stopped him.
Good play by Matt Johnner. They got him away from the pressure.
Now they keep it on the ground to Henley. Left side showing some explosiveness, and he crosses the 40 down to the 37-yard line.
And this offensive line's got to make holes just like that. Scott Whitaker is the best of the group right there. They have two sophomores and a freshman in that group. And then the running backs, June Henley, Mark Sanders. Henley is the star player. Isaac Byrd, he is a big-time receiver, and he will stretch this secondary of the University of Texas.
Pickup of 9 on the play sets up a second and 1. We played just over 2 minutes here in the opening quarter. On the ground again, and on second and 1, Henley dancing his way up to about the 42, 43-yard line as we look at the Longhorn defense.
This is an improving Texas defense. Casey Hampton has played wonderfully. He's a true freshman. Chris Akins is a big-time All-American type player. I love these names of Texas, Dusty and Tyson. These guys are good guys, really good linebackers for the University of Texas. And then their secondary, four seniors, probably, I think arguably, the best in terms of secondary, maybe in the country as a group of players. Four seniors, they play together a lot. They move like one very tightly seamless unit.
Well, one thing Kansas wanted to do, Steve, coach is telling us, they want to establish the run, but that's something they saw in previous Texas opponents, how important it is to get the ground game going.
That's it. And the thing is, if they can get some momentum, that creates all the sort of positive they need, right. Plus the win, they can throw it here.
Second play action pass for Johnner. Lofts it up in the air. Pass is complete down to the 17-yard line to the big tight end, Jim Moore. Only his 7th reception of the year. That play-action pass is successful.
I can imagine that Texas did not expect Matt Johnner to come out and get so mobile outside. He's doing things that he's not shown the ability to do. Jim Moore, as you said, that's his only 7th pass. He's more of a blocking tight end. These are the kind of things, the abnormal things, that Kansas is going to have to do to put this game in a chance where they've got a chance to win.
Pickup of 19 on the play. Henley this time is tripped up as he gets inside the 20. Probably no gain on the play. Tyson King coming up from the linebacker spot to make the stop. But Golden Rule, Pat Rule, the offensive coordinator for Kansas, he has been frustrated, I think, a little bit this year because of inconsistencies on offense. But when you're playing Texas, why not throw everything at them?
Yeah, you got two games to go. This is not a time to be conservative.
There's Pat Rule, one of the personable coaches you'll ever meet. Great guy to hang around. Now we're going to have our first penalty of the afternoon. Referee is Hal Dowden. Now, Brian Nooner is the one who has to brave the sidelines, and I hope you have your rain gear on, partner.
Hey, I've got it on, and you mentioned at the top of the show how strong the winds are. The bad news is these winds are expected to increase, and when they come in, the rain is expected in about an hour. Now, this obviously will have an impact on the game, all aspects, passing, kicking, and play calling. It's tough to hear at the line of scrimmage.
How can that wind get any harder? Henley out of pitch, and Jackson Green in front of him. Chris Carter finally rides June Henley out of bounds at the 10-yard line. But it is another, or close to another, first down for Kansas. They'll be about 3 yards short. This has been a difficult year for this young man.
Pat Rule, the offensive coordinator, pulls the option play out on Texas. I don't think they would have ever thought they would have got an option play all day today. And what that does, that causes people to think differently. There's the block of Isaac Byrd being able to keep the defender, Bryant Westbrook, away from making the tackle. Good job by Byrd to keep in front of him.
Third down and two. Johnner from the shotgun. Texas bringing some guys up the middle. Henley tries to dance toward the first down, but Tyson King was the first one to really penetrate. Chris Akins playing with that sore ankle, also in on the stop. That'll bring up a fourth down play for Kansas. They're not taking any chances. They're going to kick it. Jeff McCord, 6 of 11 this year. Texas has blocked one field goal already this year. They've also blocked five punts. This is about a 27-yarder. The kick is up and away, and it is good. McCord gets the Jayhawks on the board first. 3-0, 10-16 left in the first. And Big 12 football will return after these local messages. And we are back to a very windy Lawrence, Kansas. Jeff McCord's 27-yard field goal at the 10-16 mark has given the Jayhawks the 3-0 advantage. He is set to kick it away. Once again, the wind says bye-bye. Dorothy and Toto could not have returned that kick. Well, the teams that have been successful against Texas have been able to hold the ball and keep it away from Texas's offense. And this one took 8 plays, 48 yards. Just over 3 minutes. Henley already 24 yards rushing the football.
And what's important about that is the defense was able to give them 3 plays and punt and turn the ball to the offense to set up that drive. So again, the defensive play setting the tempo of the ball game. John Makovic told us that what he really felt was important is to get a quick start, make something good happen. They've got the tough road because of the wind being against them.
And he says he's not going to be afraid to throw the ball early. But against this wind, it's going to be tough. Holmes and Williams now in the backfield for the Longhorns. James Brown goes to the tight end, Pat Fitzgerald, and he crosses the 30 up to the 31-yard line. That'll be a first down. Pat Fitzgerald out of Agoura, California, went unrecruited. Despite the fact he had 1,200 on his SAT, he said he wanted to go to Stanford or UCLA, but nobody wanted him out there. Glenn Mason in his 9th season made some interesting comments about this team has to remember, despite the fact the record this year will not match last year's, they have to remember where they've come from and how well they have built this program. They keep it on the ground, and Ricky Williams bounces off one tackle and finally knocked out of bounds at about the 40-yard line. They call him Little Earl. Look at the thighs and the build on this young man. And believe it or not, he's also a baseball player.
There's nothing little about him. I don't know why they call him. I mean, I know why Little Earl, but...
You got to love a guy that has a Mighty Mouse tattoo on his body. Not anything, you know, rough and tumble. Mighty Mouse. Pickup of 9 on the play sets up a 2nd and 1 for the Longhorns. Ball on the 40-yard line. Brown changing the play. Three-step drop, gets it out quickly, far side, passes complete to Mike Adams. His second reception of the afternoon. Good for a first down, and James Brown showing a little confidence to throw into that win on a timing pattern.
Kansas had walked up, everyone was covered, they were in man, and they were very tight. They had literally 10 men in the kind of the forcing unit of the defense, and then James Brown checks off, then they back off into more conventional coverage.
This is a good Kansas defense at times. They have forced a turnover in 17 consecutive games, but only two turnovers have been forced the last two games. Williams breaks through, showing the power of Earl Campbell. In the Kansas territory, Tony Blevins is the one who finally made the stop from his free safety position. Pickup of 11 on the play. Another Texas first down.
What makes running work is blocking the offensive line. Watch the surge. You don't see a blue jersey penetrating. That's why Ricky Williams is able to break in the secondary, forcing Tony Blevins to make the tackle.
Williams, three carries, 25 yards. Longhorns finding success on the ground, but this time they're tripped up. It is Williams again.
By Ronnie Ward.
Ronnie Ward coming up from that linebacker spot. Last five games, Ward has put together 72 tackles. Well, they call this backfield at Texas the BMW offense. And it is a high-performance offense at times. That last five games, though, totally, the Texas offense has done much better, averaging over 480 yards a game as opposed to just over 300 in the first four games. Lone setback, it is Ricky Williams. No place to go once he reaches the 40, and once again it is Ronnie Ward, the leading tackler on this Jayhawk defense.
And what Kansas defensively is trying to do, they're getting eight men, really looking like an eight-man front. They're walking up their strong safety, number 24, Mo Gaddy, and that's trying to stop the run or at least cause them to throw the ball into this wind. So far, Texas is able to overcome that, and they're running the ball.
Big third down play for the Longhorns. Split backfield, third and eight. Right up the middle, Williams. Look out, he's got some blockers and some room. Down inside the 25-yard line, knocked out of bounds at the 21-yard line. A pickup of about 19 on the play for Ricky Williams. That counter trap seemed to really open up big time on that left side.
Watch the University of Texas on a play that they really like to work. See that hole right there that he makes clear, makes it happen? Oh, the offensive line of Texas is being able to control that defensive front of Kansas, and that was the big issue about setting the tempo.
Texas wide open again, another running room, goal line coming up, touchdown Texas.
Sean Mitchell for the Longhorn touchdown.
Mitchell had a 65-yarder last week against Texas Tech. This one was good for 21, and Steve, you mentioned it, that offensive line opening up big holes.
I really believe if the offensive line could make things happen in the front and control Houston, McGraw, and Cope, that front three of Kansas, that they could run the ball and just out-physical the University of Kansas, and so far that's what they've done.
Schultes the holder. Phil Dawson, 36 of 38 on extra point attempts this year. Right down the gut. Kansas kicks a field goal, and Texas comes right back to answer with 7. 7-3 is our score, and we'll be back right after this word from Dr. Pepper, proud sponsor of the Big 12 championship game. Carries last week, this week, he's got 23 yards, but 21 of them coming on a touchdown run. Gives the Longhorns a 7-3 lead with 7:50 left in quarter number one. Along with Brian Nooner and Steve Davis, I'm Ron Thulin. Glad you can be with us today as it is the big time in the Big 12. Chris Stockton will kick it away. Eric Vance set to receive the kick. It will be Van. Has some running room. up to the 29-yard line. Van, who had a 100-yard return versus Oklahoma earlier. Let's take a look at Texas's touchdown.
Right there's Dan Neal, and you're going to see a running back that's right here, Gerald Coleman, the fullback, that's going to make the block. Watch them make the penetration. Watch the blocks that they run. That makes the hole. I could drive a BMW through that hole. Or a Lincoln Mercury product, as our producer told me.
Well, you got to mention the sponsor, Steve. You and I won't be back.
Well, no, I was playing off of the BMW.
Well, I thought that was good. I caught it. Okay. Our producer's a little slow.
My father caught it.
And Johnner on that play action was successful in their first series. This pass off the mark. He had a man open. As Texas went 80 yards, took them only 8 plays in 2 minutes and 26 seconds. 63 of those 80 yards came on the ground. Texas 5-4 overall, 4-2 in conference play. Heading into this game, the Jayhawks at 4-5. But Mason said he is a little disappointed in this year.
Here is where Kansas can't let up. They cannot lose confidence. Or they've got to keep pushing, pressing, regardless of what's happening in the ball game. Good job.
Well, they are having success running the football. Henley again straight up the middle before Dusty Renfro knocks him down.
June Henley, really, the 6th leading rusher in the country. Good hold, good block by Eric Galbraith, number 30, his fullback, to put him into the secondary past around those linebacker areas. Good job by Kansas.
And by running the football, they're taking the pressure off Matt Johnner, something that Glenn Mason wanted to do. Well, the whistle and a timeout. The snap count was getting down to 0. Matt Johnner called the timeout, and Glenn Mason's going to talk about it. 7 minutes left in the first. The Longhorns lead.
The adventure discovered sweepstakes.
I've been shopping. It's all right here on my Discover card statement.
Use your Discover card and you could win everything on Boyd Matson's statement and join him on
a National Geographic filming expedition.
It pays to discover.
Take a look at this. With Nations Bank PC Banking, this is how you pay your bills. See this thing here? Click on that. Then you go to this little doodad and click on that. Then you type in that. Do that. Oh, am I being too technical? Anyway, with Nations Bank PC Banking, you can pay all your bills like this anytime you want to.
Texas leading it by 4-7-3, and Texas coach John Makovic knows in order to be successful against Kansas, they can't let Henley run wild.
Of course, everyone likes for the defense to just stop the other team cold and give them nothing. But I think if you can make them work hard in what they want to do, and give little in that regard. For example, don't let June Henley just get the ball and run. If he gets yards and they want to give it to him many, many times, okay, we can't decide that. But we can play good defense, force him to run hard, not give him easy yardage, and then that forces them to pass on a certain timetable. If he gets yards easily, then they pass on whatever timetable they want, and that makes it much more difficult to play defense.
And that point's well taken because you want to try to set the tempo on defense and not let the offense with their running game set the tempo.
Henley right up the middle. Wow. Spinning, what a great move by June Henley. Stiff-arming his way up to the 35-yard line, and we have a penalty flag thrown. Chris Carter running him out of bounds, the senior out of Tyler, Texas. Henley last week only 42 yards on 19 carries versus K-State. Much better today, and the face mask will add a couple more yards to that.
Kansas offensive line's fighting through. Gary Mosier, number 95, is a sophomore. They get blocked. He gets sucked inside, and that puts June Henley into the secondary. Good job by Kansas front, Hunt, Stiebel, Roberts, to be able to control that front three of the University of Texas.
And Henley's going to take a breather. First and 10, ball's on the 29-yard line. Kansas has showed some offensive success here in the first quarter. First drive, they kick the field goal. Johnner got some running room. He's got a block. Inside the 20, down to the 15, and finally brought down at the 13-yard line. 16-yard gain on the play by Matt Johnner, the junior out of Costa Mesa, California. There you see big Cleve Roberts, that offensive line, giving him some time and also opening up a hole.
Nothing will excite Kansas more than the Matt Johnner to have plays like this. They're impromptu, and he goes make something happen. He knows he's got to play big today. Good job by him to recognize the receivers are covered, jump upfield, go get yards, put emotion in this offensive team.
And what we saw there, too, Steve, is he didn't hesitate, and that's something the coaches don't want him to do. They want him to make a decision, make it quickly, because if he hesitates, his ability isn't such that it'll carry him through.
Yeah, and that's a big difference between him and Roots, who's hurt. Johnner is more analytical, more methodical in his style. He would think about it, tend to think about it too much because he didn't want to make a mistake. Now just be instinctive, go play, go make plays.
Second and six. Ball on the 10-yard line. We are inside of 6 minutes here in the opening quarter. Henley. Not much running room. He does get inside the 10-yard line. Maybe a yard on the carry. Dusty Renfro again at the bottom of the pile. And there is big Clarence Martin out of Oceanside, California. Clarence Martin, a very interesting story. His parents had some drug problems. He was homeless at the age of 14. And now he's making a name for himself on the collegiate level of football. Third and five, Henley the lone setback. Great call by Pat Rule. Henley has the first down as he bowls his way down to the three. Again, Dusty Renfro, the name to be called.
Great job by the offensive line of Kansas to become actors. I mean, they're part of the Screen Actors Guild here. Being able to watch them, they release their blocks, they just let them go, kind of give a halfway block, and then setting up the screen. And good call, you're right. Pat Rule made a big call there to put them in a screen play. They knew they were going to get the hard rush on a third and five situation.
Do you feel they've got Texas on their heels defensively? They're getting Johnner out of the pocket, trying to get him moving a little bit.
Yeah, and the other thing is they're building confidence for the offense. The defense did a good job the first drive of putting Texas back three plays and out. Then they gave up the big drive, and now Kansas is responding and coming down the field, literally the distance of the field, making things happen.
Chris Akins comes out of the lineup from that defensive tackle spot. There's Pat Rule. You know, one thing about Kansas, they're keeping it simple. And it seems like this year when they have kept it simple offensively, they've done so much better. First and goal, ball's on the three. They get it to the main man. Touchdown, Kansas. June Henley has just set a new record in Kansas football history for most points. He only needed three. He just got six. Henley's 16th rushing touchdown this year. High snap, and McCord's able to put it through. Kansas has regained the lead, and we've got an old-fashioned shootout here in Lawrence.
What a huge drive by Kansas. What really made the difference, Ron, I think, is that Kansas is playing physical against Texas. Teams that have played well against Texas have been able to match up to them physically and play tough, rock 'em, sock 'em, in-your-face football. Watch June Henley at the goal line make contact on Chris Carter and drive the ball into the end zone. That's the kind of physical play Kansas will have to sustain all game long.
Well, of course, Kansas trying to become bowl eligible. They need to win their final two games of the year. Here's the bowl eligibility. As you can see, Texas needs one win. Tech, A&M needs a couple. Kansas and Baylor both need two. It is a tough road here in the Big 12 Conference, folks, to try to become bowl eligible when you have eight conference games. But Colorado, Nebraska, and K-State already in the bowl picture.
You know, when you look at the South and the North Division, one of the reasons, you know, people have kind of been, not critical, but they've kind of looked at the Southern Division. The reason the Southern Division's much tighter is that they're younger teams. They're more inexperienced. They're really building their programs with younger talent, and that's why they've played so tight, and that's why they've had the upsets and the up-and-down year in that Southern Division. But it's been competitive.
We could save a lot of agony if they just go ahead and put it at the 20 and not even let anybody kick with a win. Let's just start at the 20. If you can't kick out of the end zone, you shouldn't be playing. Let's take a look at our Dr. Pepper roundup. Penn State, are they headed to the Alamo Bowl? We're going to find out. Clemson leading. And it's also Temple on top of Boston College in the second. Florida taking on Brad Scott, South Carolina Gamecocks. Tennessee, Wisconsin trailing Iowa. That is in the first. Here it is, a 10-9 game. Kansas has taken over the lead. Or 10-7 game, I should say. 4:49 left to play in the first. Whoop, Mitchell bounces out to the right side. Picking up five on the play before Maurice Gaddy, the junior out of Detroit, Michigan, makes the stop. He's the big play guy for that Kansas defense.
What you like about these running backs at the University of Texas is that they block for each other. Watch Ricky Williams, number 11, lead the way for Sean Mitchell right there, making that block. That's a big play. He knows he's going to get blocked later from Sean. That's the kind of effort. That's how they complement each other as a tandem of running backs.
Split backfield with Mitchell and Williams. Play action, Brown. Dumps it off to Ricky Williams. He's got some running room. Inside the 50, run out of bounds at the Kansas 43-yard line. Both offensive coordinators pulling out all the tricks today. A pickup of 32 on that play.
Kansas first and 10, Texas at the 43.
What makes the play tough is the linebackers have to get isolated on Ricky Williams, and they're out of position. They can't make the play. They get sucked inside off the play action pass, or the play action, and then Ricky Williams is able to get a soft touch from James Brown. Notice Texas is not going down the field throwing the ball. It's just pick and choose. It's being very selective in their pass game against the wind.
Once again, showing patience. That's the 21st reception for Williams this year. This time he stacked up and fumbles, but I think it popped right back into his own hands. Ronnie Ward is the one cracking the pads down below. John Makovic said this Kansas defense is a lot like Michigan's. I thought that was an interesting comparison.
Well, there are a lot of slants in their style of play. They really, and they're playing much more physical and tougher today than I've seen them play in the past. This is a well-coached defense in front of the ball. Boy, he's lucky. The ball pops up.
You never had any of those. You never had any of those. When it popped up, it was gone. Second and seven. Brown being pressured, dumps it off again. Pat Fitzgerald inside the 30. Fitzgerald, who when he got out of high school thought running back was his best position, but now with 6'2", 230 pounds, I think tight end's pretty good. He's got that Fu Manchu working. He could be a WWF kind of guy. Look at that. Or a linebacker.
He caught more touchdown passes than any tight end in the country last year. He caught eight. Coming into the ballgame with 22 receptions. I mean, he can make plays, and the guy has the ability to break pass coverages. He can take it deep.
Williams looking to get up to the 25-yard line. Jason Thorne from the linebacker spot, along with Chris Jones, coming up to make the stop. That'll bring up a second down and about nine to go for this Texas Longhorn offense.
Number 38, Jason Thorne, back on offense. It's a gain of one.
Come on, D.
Second down and nine at the 26.
Come on, Chris Jones.
The running game was the first concern for Mike Hankwitz and this Kansas defense. Texas has shown some success. Brown, the pump fake, has a man open. Incomplete. Intended for Pat Fitzgerald. Maurice Gaddy coming up to make the coverage. That play looked like it was going to develop early on, but it never did.
They had Fitzgerald and Matt Davis, the split end and the tight end in the pattern. Again, it's very tough when you're trying to throw a touch type throw against a heavy wind because you don't know how much touch to put on the ball.
And it looked like Matt Davis was open on that play. On third and nine, again, they keep it on the ground. And again, they get the first down.
Out of bounds at the Jayhawk 10.
The wind really beginning to kick up. A pickup of 16 for Ricky Williams.
Game 16.
We said that you had to be physical in this football game. Listen.
The Rydells are popping.
And I'm glad it's not me.
Every day you're up here, it's glad
it
it's
makes
not
my
you.
Head hurt.
Nine carries, 67 yards already for Ricky Williams. Mitchell breaking through, almost had the six. Mitchell had the cut, cutting back like he did last week against Tech, but they just got a hand on the ankle. That was good enough.
Sean Mitchell is a physical back. He can do magic tricks with a football. Good job to be able to wrap him up at the ankles. That is hard to do with him. He can break tackles. He's physically surprising when you watch him. He's got more strength and more power and the ability to break tackles than you give him credit for.
Second and goal, ball's on the three. Freeze Holmes, touchdown, Texas.
Texas touchdown.
Holmes' seventh touchdown rush of the year.
Attempting the extra point is Phil Dawson, number four.
Straight ahead, zone blocking by the University of Texas. He's going to cut back behind his big tackle, Jay Humphrey, number 67, and crawl into the end zone. It still counts however you get there.
Didn't play last year because of injuries. And the extra point is good. We are still in the first quarter. 24 points have already been scored. Brees Holmes touchdown gives Texas the lead again, 14-10. Send it down to Brian Nooner on the sideline. Brian, you still dry?
Yeah, still dry, still windy. But I want to talk about Chris Akins, the fine nose tackle for Texas. You know, you mentioned that he's nursing a sore right ankle. Well, last week against Texas Tech, number 96 only was involved in three plays. Well, he's already tripled that total today. And Coach John Makovic said that could be the key to the defense today, how much Akins is able to go. So far, he's doing fine, but they did pull him out on that last series. It'll be interesting to see if he comes back on this defensive series.
Well, on that last series, Kansas ran right at him for three plays. The squib kick bounces up. Kansas is going to get good field position. Hosea Friday, number 13, normally a tight end. It bounced right into his hands. I'm not sure if that was by design or if he just mishit it. There's Priest Holmes, whose touchdown gave the Longhorns the lead. Took him nine plays and once again, 80 yards. Just over 3.5. You know, Steve, we talked at the beginning of the show about starting fast. It was important. What do we do now? Both teams have started fast.
Now you just hang on and keep going.
You go for the ride.
You extend it to the second quarter.
Okay, we'll start fast in the second quarter. Consistency then. Johnner taking his time, throws it away. Probably a pretty good decision by Matt Johnner as we take a look at the total yards. The only reason Texas has more is they've had the ball one more time. But it is important for him to make those good decisions, Stephen, not try to force the pass.
And sometimes throwing the ball away is the best decision, and that can be a good decision. What I like about Matt Johnner today, I just noticed a little bit more action in his step. He just seems more confident. Those first couple of drives have really made a difference for him, and that I think it'll make give some benefits to Kansas throughout the game.
Henley cutting back against the grain. He made lemonade out of lemons. Wasn't a whole lot of running room. We've had Kansas three times against Oklahoma, against Colorado in this game. This is the best I've seen June Henley run by far.
Well, he does appear to be running a somewhat of an inspired game today. I mean, he is highly thought of by these coaches. You know, he was suspended against the Nebraska game. He's hungry. He wants to win. He wants to contribute. He was excited about getting into this game against Texas. They realized the importance of it. I mean, that's just great play. Nobody made the kind of blocks that made that play work. He made the run.
That is his 12th carry. He is now over 80 yards running the football.
Maybe I was wrong. Maybe Jude Henley can win the game on his own.
I know. I tell you, he's doing the effort today, isn't he? Well, Henley had 216 yards rushing the football against Utah, but then he put together a string of three games where he didn't break 80. Then he gets 226 versus Iowa and only 42 last week versus K-State. Glenn Mason told us a couple of weeks ago that's because our offensive line was terrible during those stretches.
Yeah, and I tell you, the other thing is, if you watch him there real close, he's smiling.
That's a good sign. We briefly mentioned it's been a difficult year for him. Johnner's pass is incomplete. Intended for Eric Van, it hit him in the hands. It was a difficult catch, but it should have been made.
Matt threw it a little bit low, but Eric Van needed to come back a little more aggressively and go for the ball because he was wide open. Van had done a great job of pushing those defensive secondary backs off to give him room. He had plenty of room to catch the ball.
Only 5 seconds remain in this opening quarter. Texas leads it 14-10. Only one more play with the win for this Jayhawk team in this half. Johnner takes advantage of it. Pass is complete. First down. Kansas, the ball is loose, but John Gordon was down before he popped out of his hands, the true freshman from West Palm Beach, Florida. A very smooth receiver gives Kansas the first down as the first quarter comes to an end. It is a shootout, the first 15, but Texas leads it 14-10. We'll be back right after this word from Citgo. Look for the sign of quality throughout Big 12 country. Citgo says go. 10 is our score as we begin quarter number two. Brian Nooner's on the sideline, bearing out the wind. Steve and I are upstairs, nice and warm. Just rub it in. At right side of the Texas defense, jumping a little too quickly. Gray Mosier. Great story about Gray Mosier as we listen to the call.
Dead ball. Ball start. On the offense. Still first
down. On the offense. Gray Mosier likes rodeo. Said he could have gone to school on a rodeo scholarship. He does like calf roping and all that stuff. He said, but the coaches have sort of told him, let's lay off that during football season.
The coach is describing, say, he's a real Texas guy. I love these names. I mean, I
Gray.
Just, you know, Gray and Casey and Tyson and Dusty.
It's good defensive name.
Yeah, it is. It really is.
He's from Bernie, Texas, which is just outside of San Antonio.
Wow.
Henley, big hole over the right side. Oh, my goodness. Henley just lowering the head, knocking the DBs back about 3 or 4 yards. Carter, I think, is going to have to shake some cobwebs out. 17 yards on the carry.
Watch the blocks inside for June Henley. I mean, they're manhandling Casey Hampton, the true freshman. I mean, he's a 317-pounder, and watch the hit that he puts on Chris Carter. I've never seen June Henley run as physical and as determined as he is today.
Look at that, over the century mark already, where he only played 14 seconds in quarter number two. Johnner gets it out to Hosea Friday. He looked like he just batted it down. Let's go back to that last play. Watch this contact.
Runs into Chris Carter. Chris Carter makes the choice to run into June Henley, maybe. It's a physical game. If you take the game to Texas physically, it tends to provide some benefits.
I think Bill Bates, Dallas Cowboy, can remember that kind of hit when Herschel Walker lowered the boom on him in a Georgia-Tennessee game. I think Chris Carter's looking out his ear hole right now. Henley again. Big hole. Look out. Goodbye. Whoever has the ball last may win the football game. A 17-yard touchdown run for June Henley. His second of the ball game.
Cleve Roberts, number 77, the right guard of Kansas, pulled on the play. He took his man all the way to the sideline. If it had pushed him any farther, he would have been in Topeka. I mean, he blew him out.
That wasn't the wind doing that. Jeff McCord on for the extra point. With 14:37 left in the first half, Kansas on top by three. Early in the second quarter, and Texas finds themselves down 17-14 in the first quarter, and a couple second track meet we've got going on. You made a great point as we look at June Henley on the side, and Steve during the commercial, he said, you know, I'm seeing the Kansas guys smile, and it looks like they're having fun for the first time in a number of games.
Great execution early in the ball game against an overly favored opponent builds confidence and equalizes everything.
Mike Scarborough and Sean Mitchell are back to receive the kick. They've got to hold it because of the wind. McCord with a 9-iron. It's going to be Mike Scarborough, the kamikaze kick returner. Young man likes some contact. Gets it up to about the 40, and that is where Texas will begin play.
Okay, there's a couple of things. This is Cleve Roberts, number 77. He's going to pull and make a great block on Chris Carter, number 16. Then you're going to see number one, Isaac Bird, make a block on Bryant Westbrook and keep him out of the play. There's what right there. He's keeping him out of the play, and that puts June Henley into the end zone.
Isaac Bird, of course, also playing as we look at Big Cleve Roberts, but Isaac Bird also plays professional baseball. Just like Ricky Williams of Texas. But Bird showing us some blocking ability. We knew he could catch the football. Brown has a man wide open over the 50 down to the 45. It is Pat Fitzgerald, the tight end. The first team academic All-American coming down with the pigskin. Texas at the Kansas 45-yard line, pickup of 21.
One thing, Texas will not panic. They're playing their kind of game. They're hanging in there. They're being smart. No one's losing focus on what their assignments are, and that's what John Makovic wanted to do all the way through. Be patient. Just keep coming at them, running our game in style.
And hope your defense comes up with a stop. Williams, right side. Every time he touches the ball, he makes something happen. But if you're Kansas, are you afraid of getting into a track meet with Texas? Because Kansas State last week, they only trailed by two at halftime, and they ended up losing in a big way.
Well, I don't know that you'd be afraid to get in a track meet if you can keep the ball game very tight and your offense is moving the ball, and even though you're giving up a lot of yards, and if you're able to move the ball, I mean, you want to take stretch Texas to the fourth quarter. They have shown a propensity to struggle in the fourth quarter. Kansas wants to keep it tight because what they do is it creates all sorts of benefits for them.
Brown trying to hit the corner. Tries to cut back, dives forward to the 32-yard line. Pickup of five on the play. Brett McGraw is the one who is really putting the pressure on. Let's take a look at this afternoon, Southwest Airlines storyline. A couple of touchdowns for Texas by Owen Mitchell.
Coverage downfield.
Henley, two touchdowns into the wind. Texas put up a couple. Kansas put up one.
But on both of those drives, all those drives into the wind, there were not really big, long pass plays. They were all kind of dinks, small, short passes. Exactly. Really a controlled passing attack against the wind.
Williams, the lone setback, two wide receivers wide to the right. They dump it over the middle. It is complete for the tight end, Pat Fitzgerald. Nice job juggling the football and bringing it in before he was hit.
There's the tight end right there. He'll hesitate, and then he'll come across. Right there, kind of bobbles the ball. Very good hands by a 6'2", 228-pound senior. He can make plays all over the field. He's done a good job blocking this afternoon.
Second and six. Mitchell runs into his own guy. He's tripped up right at the line of scrimmage. Let's send it down to Brian Nuta. Brian?
I'll tell you what, with these wind conditions, it's definitely affecting the play calling. When Kansas had the win at its back, Matt Johnner threw the ball seven times. He had some success as he completed four. Now Texas has the ball with the win at its back. Already James Brown has gone up top twice on this drive alone.
Well, you can see the wind at the top of the stadium. It is very, very strong. Still no rain. They keep telling us it's coming. Third and five. James Brown was trying to call a timeout, but before he did, there was a penalty flag thrown, and now Brown is trying to say, I called timeout before he jumped. Now it's up to the officials to decipher this one. This is a tough call for those three gentlemen.
Trying to determine whether it's a dead ball. If it was not, if he didn't get the timeout, and Jay Humphrey, number 67, is to pull back. There's Jay.
That's one of those bang bang plays, though. Must have picked it up.
Disregard the flag from the timeout.
Well, let's see if it was a timeout.
Still for 27.
No.
Well, the replay didn't lie, but we do have a timeout, 11:35, with Kansas leading by three in the second. Back right after this word from Dr. Pepper, proud sponsor of the Big 12 championship game.
Glenn Mason has every reason to be upset and disappointed. Watch on the replay. Right there is Glenn Mason. Watch his reaction. He knows it's going to be a third down and 11 now, and that's why he's excited, but he doesn't get the break.
No, he doesn't. And during the timeout, he let the officials know that it was a bad call, and he had a beef. 11:35 left to play in the first half. We've got a dandy going on here in Lawrence, Kansas, with bowl implications, championship implications. You can see neither team able to stop the other. Third and five. Brown going for it all and overthrows the intended receiver, Mike Adams. Steve, you talked at the beginning of the game when we were talking about the wind, about a ball hydroplaning when you're throwing with the wind. That ball seemed like it just took off.
Well, what happens? The wind just takes the ball and it just doesn't want to come down. It's just carried. So it's really a touch throw that you've got to make. There's the isolation on Mike Adams, number 83. He's really picked up well by Jason Harris, number 23, who's all over him. Tough throw with the wind. The wind plays havoc both sides, both ways.
One of the best kickers in all of college football, Phil Dawson. Ball is planted at the 34-yard line, a 44-yard attempt. He's got the wind with him, and he didn't get it. Went to the left. That is only Dawson's fifth miss this year. One of those was a block. So we have our first stop.
Here's the perspective of the kick that Phil Dawson was looking at, and he just pulls it just inside to the left. Was the hold good? Everything looked just right the way Phil Dawson would want it, and he just pulls it to his left. One of the things we said about the must for Kansas, that they had to figure out a way to get bonus points. Something had to happen that doesn't generally happen. Phil Dawson missing a field goal. Maybe that's one
that
of them.
May be it. Dawson kicked that big field goal last week against Texas Tech, but probably one of his most memorable field goals came a year ago against Virginia. Kicked a 50-yarder into the wind to give the Longhorns the victory. But he misses there.
Ron, I'm sorry. In games like this, when it's really tight, you can't lose your emotion, your focus. You can't ever let up. The team that lets up will lose the ball game. You've got to stay intense all the way through.
This was successful for Johnner early. The pass is somehow complete. Eric Van made the reception, his 18th of the year. But boy, I tell you what, Johnner threaded the needle on that one.
Every throw that Matt Johnner has made has been a confident throw. Again, they're rolling him, getting away from the pressure. That's not what Texas. He almost took the head of Jim Moore, is tied in off, throwing the ball to Eric Van. Getting away from it. I think Texas really is surprised that Johnner's being able to be mobile today.
I think it was Chris Akins jumping off, and it was the big dog, they call him. Well, big dog, a little too early.
Dead ball. Defense, offside, still first down.
Watch the front line of Texas. That's an ugly play.
That is very.
That's just an ugly play.
We got to get the ugly play sponsored by somebody. You have our ugly play of the game. On first and five, Kansas is going to keep it on the ground. And June Henley over 100 yards rushing the football already this afternoon. One Casey Hampton, stop, Steve, sir.
I'm sorry, Ron. One of the storylines is really the inside. Jim Steeble, number 55, he's been a guard. He moved over when Jared Smith was injured. He's working on Casey Hampton, that true freshman. Here's a guy that's 317 pounds, very talented, big play potential, but his play is real key. And right now, the senior is having a pretty good, successful day against Hampton, the freshman.
On second and three, the Jayhawks pick up yet another first down. To the chance of June. And he gives a little pump of the fist. One thing the Kansas coaches wanted to do was get Johnner out of the pocket, move him around a little bit more. They've done that today and it's been very successful, giving him ample opportunity to be successful. Texas almost jumping off sides again. Johnner, this time the pressure's on and the pass is incomplete. We do have a penalty flag thrown. It was right at the line of scrimmage. A lot of movement on the line.
Another reason for the success we're seeing out of Henley, the running backs of Kansas, is that they're going at Chris Akins, number 96, who's had injury with his right ankle. That's impaired a little bit of his agility, and so when he's in the ball game, you see Kansas going at him also. Watch the left side of the screen. There's the jump. Texas has got to be patient.
June Henley with another carry. Tyson King on the stop. Picks up maybe a yard or two on the play.
Well, Pat Rule, the offensive coordinator of Kansas, said if they could get something going, set the tempo early in the ballgame. I can't say that the tempo edge is with Kansas or Texas, but what it has benefited Kansas, they're confident, they're having some early game success, and on top of that, they've got the lead that's building all the positive they needed early in the game.
Henley again, lunging forward, trying to get the first down. The penetration by Tyson King really caused June Henley to trip up. One thing that has plagued this Kansas ball club throughout the year are mental mistakes, and that's something they really have to stay away from. Now it seems like we're settling down just a little bit offensively. It's now the team that's going to make the least number of mistakes.
Yeah, and the other thing they really were kind of bugged about is that they don't feel like they played as a team effort as well as they did in 95, that there was a better team concept, and that's what they've been struggling to get in 1996.
Over the top, Henley jumping up for the first down. That was a great graphic, and I don't know if we can get it up one more time, guys in the truck, but that has been part of the problem with Kansas. They haven't been able to establish their running game the last few contests. Today, over 140 yards rushing the football. They're closing in on their game average of 164.
3 yards on the play, first down.
And so much can happen. I don't think you can underestimate how much a good running game does to your total offense.
Oh, for Kansas, what it does is, number one, it takes the pressure off of their quarterback. It does a great job of allowing Matt Johnner to gain his confidence, to make better plays, to get the movement he needs. The other thing, it takes pressure off the defense.
Whistle, we're gonna stop it. Little motion maybe on Kansas. Last home game of the year for the Kansas Jayhawks. Of course, they conclude their season next Saturday at Missouri.
False start on the offense. Still first down.
Well, we talked about mental mistakes. That's one of them. Glenn Mason learned how to coach from the very beginning from a guy by the name of Woody Hayes. Woody Hayes' best advice to Glenn Mason: when you go someplace, plan on staying there 25 years.
And one of the things that Glenn Mason has adopted from the Woody Hayes era is the fire.
That's right.
I mean, the guy has fire. He's intense in what he does and believes strongly in what he does here at Kansas.
That's another ugly play. Johnner is dumped unintentionally. Tim Warfield, I think, at that defensive tackle spot. may have jumped.
Dead ball, offside, on the defense. Go for it.
And they give it right back to him.
You know, we've had a lot of those. Brian made the comment earlier about it's difficult to hear because that wind is creating noise down on the field and coming at you. But it has really been sloppy at times when they've not been able to get the snap count and have a clean start.
Now Glenn Mason wanted to create momentum from any source he possibly could. June Henley has been the momentum getter so far for them. We've had three penalties on this drive. Dr. Pepper roundup, Penn State leading Michigan at intermission. Clemson on top of North Carolina State at half, and Temple 7-0 over Boston College. And Florida exploded over South Carolina, still in the first half. Tennessee, hello, Phil Fulmer. And Iowa blanking Wisconsin 24-0 in the second. Second and eight, 6:50 to play in quarter number two. Now the Texas defense tightening the belt a little bit. Humphreys looks like he may be injured. Aaron Humphreys buckled over a little bit.
One thing that Kansas is trying to do, and they've been somewhat successful today, is that they're running the ball in such a way. Texas has pretty good speed on defense, and so they're taking the ball one way and looking for the cutback and trying to take advantage of by misdirection against the speed of the Texas defense.
Three-step drop pass intended for Eric Vann is incomplete. One thing we haven't seen Kansas do, and they probably were thinking Texas would expect it, they haven't gotten the ball quickly to Isaac Byrd at that wide receiver spot. You have a man as talented as that guy right there leading the receiving for Kansas. They haven't gotten him the ball as quickly as they wanted to, or at all for that matter.
Well, the defensive coaches of Texas really felt like that they were going to get a lot of pictures for Isaac Byrd to look at, so he was going to get some double coverage. They were going to mix up the coverage on him to make it tough for him to find the football today.
Interesting call for Glenn Mason on fourth down. Johnner is going to be good. Dwight Kirkpatrick with his third sack of the year, the junior out of Waller, Texas. Dwight Kirkpatrick was an option quarterback in high school. He was helped out by Tyson King. There's Dwight. But he said he wanted to go to college and play defense. Good choice.
This is a brave call for Kansas. You're going into the wind against a senior-dominated secondary and a pretty strong rush. Look how he's protected. Bryant Westbrook is maybe the best cornerbacks in the country, if not the best. I mean, that is mirroring Isaac Byrd, and that's why Matt Johnner goes to the turf.
Now, Bryant Westbrook is rated as the number two cornerback in the country, at least in preseason polls, behind Canty from Kansas State. Brown's going for the home run ball. He's got a man wide open, and it's incomplete. Mike Adams had a step or five behind the defense, but again, the ball just getting caught up in that wind and floating away.
Trying to take advantage of the big play by the defense, and the ball kind of floats. I see the ball turn completely around.
Right.
Of course, that happened to me a lot at Oklahoma, and it wasn't because of the wind, but he knew he overthrew it. It is a touch throw when you're throwing with the wind this strong behind you.
Ricky Williams still on his feet. It takes a bunch of blue jerseys to bring the little guy down. Manolito Jones and Maurice Gaddy on the stop. Yeah, they used to say Steve Davis had a good curveball. Too bad he was throwing a football.
That's right. They thought, I had receivers want a fair catch my day. They thought they were punts.
Third down and six, 5.5. We've had a couple of defensive stops. Dawson missing a field goal, then the Texas defense stopping Kansas as they went for it on fourth down. Brown stops. Dumps it off, close to the first down, fighting his way up is Wayne McGarity, the sophomore from San Antonio, Texas, just a 5'8", 190-pounder. Tony Blevins had him wrapped up, but McGarity was doing everything he could to finally get across the first down line, and he did.
look at what James Brown, everybody is covered. There's someone there. James Brown's ability to be patient, to wait on the receiver to come open. Now, and sometimes James Brown has thrown that ball and thrown it poorly, but that time his receiver had the advantage on the cornerback, and that's why he threw the ball. He's made mistakes in that very situation in the past.
Mitchell. Close to the 50-yard line, pickup of about 5.5 on the play. Ronnie Ward on the stop. Maurice Gaddy also coming in to help out.
We're seeing really three fine backs and Sean Mitchell and Ricky Williams and June Henley for Kansas. All three are running hard and doing everything they can to help set the tempo in this football game in the running game.
Mitchell, two consecutive weeks, 100 yards rushing the football, trying to make it three. Directing traffic. The pass is complete to Fitzgerald. He has another first down. His fifth reception of the afternoon for Pat Fitzgerald. He is only two away from Kerry Cash's record of 71 catches by a tight end, set between 87 and 90.
Watch what James Brown is saying. First of all, Kansas has 10 men within about 5 or 7 yards of the ball. Now watch the patience of James Brown. He's looking for an open man. He looked off three or four different receivers. Then he finds Pat Fitzgerald is tied in and completes the pass.
He's only one away from Kerry Cash. Inside of 4 minutes, Brown tosses it out into the flat and is incomplete. Fitzgerald was there. 3:54 to play in the first half. Texas trailing by three. Pat Fitzgerald getting quite a workout. You can see the numbers on James Brown, 112 yards passing the football already this afternoon. Second and 10. The Longhorns average over 230 yards passing the football each game. Williams the lone setback. Brown doesn't like what he sees. He calls a timeout. 3:54 left in the second. Facing second and 10. Texas is going to talk about it. Big final 3:54 of quarter number two, and it's been a wild one as Kansas leads at 17-14, but things seem to have calmed down just a little bit. Both defenses starting to tighten up. The leaves blowing around here at Memorial Stadium. It is game day here on the hill. Not a very big crowd, but those that are here are braving about a 40-mile-an-hour wind. Brown passes complete. Nice juke step trying to dance passes on the outside. Sean Mitchell on the reception. Only his fifth of the year.
Tackled by number 47, Patrick Brown.
Watch everybody drive deep and then watch it come back shallow. Watch Sean Mitchell, number three. There's everybody going deep and then Sean Mitchell right there out of the backfield.
Third and four for Texas. Brown, straight drop, has a man and is complete again. Pat Fitzgerald all the way down to the 10-yard line. Now we talked about the running backs doing their job. How about that guy right there? He's a dandy.
What Texas is taking advantage of is that Kansas has got to be so concerned about the run. Now they're putting pressure on the linebackers. Ronnie Ward is a linebacker inside. Now they're taking the tight end and putting him into the ball game, so they can't become kind of totally focused upon the running game. They've got to realize those people coming out of the backfield.
Mitchell is going to be dragged down from behind. Patrick Brown is the one who got in first.
Patrick Brown, number 47.
Now Kansas has to be concerned with the tight end, has to be concerned with that guy. The three running backs of Henley, Mitchell, and Williams have combined for over 260 yards running the football today. But it has been a big tight end out of California that's been one of the main stories for this Texas offense. Preseason All-American selection, Pat Fitzgerald. Second and 14, loss of four on the play. Eight men in the box for Kansas. Brown has a man open and is incomplete. Off the hands of Priest Holmes. Holmes had to turn completely around to try to make the catch. Ron Warner was putting the pressure on James Brown from that linebacker spot. He was looking after his seventh sack, didn't quite get it.
Watch the patience of James Brown. Again, this is times where he has sometimes gotten in trouble, but he just waits and waits, and he's just looking downfield trying to find the open man. In the past, he has thrown it into coverage trying to make a play.
Split backfield for Texas facing third and 14. Ricky Williams. Down to about the 7-yard line. Maurice Getty wasn't going to let him go. And Phil Dawson is going to be coming in to kick the field goal. He's already missed one. Hooked it to the left. He's going to try it again. Mark Schultes is the holder. He is the punter on the team. His miss was from 44. This one's going to be spotted at about the 14, so it'll be a 24-yard attempt for Phil Dawson. No problem for Phil Dawson. Dawson kicks his 15th field goal of the year, and we've played almost two quarters, and we're back to even, 17 apiece. It was also the first game of the year.
Yeah, a lot of talent in both the North and the South Division. This is tough, big-time football.
You got to be ready to play every week here. I know that's the cliche a lot of people use, but of the Big 12, probably more so than anything. Chris Stockton's kick again with the win out of the end zone. Texas on that last drive. It took them 12 plays to cover the 60 yards, 4 minutes and 50 seconds. The big play, though, were from Pat Fitzgerald, the tight end, a couple of catches for 34 yards. And that set up the field goal that knotted us up at 17 apiece. The way things have been going, you think that Kansas is probably just going to let the air out again. But do you want to play it safe right now with only a minute 17 left in the quarter, Steve?
No, you try to go score. You try to go make something happen. You realize you got a minute 17. Just don't make mistakes. Keep running the ball. Keep your intensity up.
Henley. Left side, good for a first down before Chris Carter runs him out. And I think you made a good point. I was hoping you would say that. I think a lot of teams have a tendency when they play it safe, they lose that intensity. All of a sudden, you get comfortable. You can't do that. You have to play to win, not play not to lose.
No, and I don't think you play to get into the dressing room and pat everybody on the back that you're tied up with Texas. I think you go make things happen, try to move the ball. I mean, you've got to put everything you can to keep the level up and the building the confidence has been so key for Kansas. Don't destroy it by just laying on the ball.
Boy, you can hear the pads cracking up here. Henley picking up about 8 on the play. Trey Thomas is the one who really lowered the head out of this senior from Sugarland, Texas. Henley over 160 yards rushing the football. He scored a couple of times. 48 seconds, it doesn't seem like Kansas is in any big hurry to try to do anything. And the fans are booing. Bird split wide to the left. Henley, left side. Aaron Humphrey, the true freshman on the stop. He leads all true freshmen in tackles in the Big 12 Conference. That may have been the last play of the quarter. Only 16 seconds left to play in the half. Third and less than a yard. And Glenn Mason is just going to let it run out to a resounding round of boos. But he can still muster the smile. Well, we played knockdown dragout, Steve, for 30 minutes, and we are going to start over back from square one, 17 apiece.
Much about the win, but has it affected your play calling significantly?
Well, there's no doubt that the wind is a factor here, and I don't know if it's really played a factor yet because neither team has been backed up and had the force to be punt into that wind. But if anything, it's in a pickup, and the weather's probably going to worsen. And That's the great thing about the game of football. Our game, we don't call it off because it's windy or hot or cold, rain or snow. We're going to go on.
As long as we don't blow over, let me get this final question in. You told us earlier in the week that the offensive line really needed to respond. In the first half, they did. The running game's going, but at the same time, you've got to stop their running game, too.
Well, that's right. It's been a really, we've been pretty consistent running the ball, and we've allowed the big play through the run of Texas and throwing the ball to the tight ends. We've got to stop that if we expect to stay close in this ballgame.
All right, well, it's close right now, tied at 17. Good luck in the second half, Coach.
Typical football coach. We don't want to stop the game because of hot or anything. We're going to keep playing no matter what the weather is. Only one punt in that first 30 minutes, by the way. Texas going against the wind to begin the third. They will have the win in the fourth. Straight up the middle. Ricky Williams again getting the first down and then some. Patrick Brown finally corralling him.
Patrick Brown, number 47 on the tackle.
Ricky Williams just busted on the play. The guard pulls. Dan Neal, 69, comes across, and then right up the middle, and they've just been able to put it. That was Brett McGraw. They were able, in Houston, Dewey Houston, they were able to put down on the University of Kansas in their defensive front.
June Henley's over 100 yards rushing. Ricky Williams is over 100 yards rushing. Papers are being scattered all over the field. Dangerous pass, but it is complete. Matt Davis making his first reception of the afternoon, the senior out of Fort Worth, Texas. His 13th reception of the year. The numbers on James Brown, and it has been a good afternoon for him. 11 for 17, over 145 yards, but the big key, no interceptions.
Yeah, and the big key is that he's not made, as you said, the interception, but he's also not thrown the bad ball.
Right.
He really has been smart when he's tried to make a play.
First and 10 for the Longhorns. Ball on the Kansas 43-yard line, opening drive, second half. Three-step drop, wide open. Mike Adams was given a lot of room by the cornerbacks of Kansas, maybe out of respect.
Texas has really speed receivers, very capable. There you see how what the official is looking at from the back end. A lot of cushion by those cornerbacks. Jason Harris, number 23, don't want to give a big play early in this third quarter, so give him a little more cushion.
On second and one, Williams tries the left side, bounces through the hole, continues to pump the legs inside the 25, down to the 24-yard line. Ricky Williams has had success, but you have to give the kudos to his offensive line.
Texas really getting good surge. I mean, there's no blue jerseys coming through. There right there is Jason Thorne, number 38. But great job of keeping that front defensive line out of the way of the running back. Good job by Texas.
The streak is now 13 of 17 for a Texas running back to go over the century mark. Dan Neal, that big right guard, putting on another pancake block. With two to snap, they get it off. Williams dances to his left, gets in the middle of the field, maybe got back to the line of scrimmage. Ronnie Ward on the stop.
The dilemma that Texas has presented to the University of Kansas, because Pat Fitzgerald, the tight end, has had a hot hand catching balls in the first half. Then they've got Mitchell and Williams, the two running backs. Kansas has got to try to have a dual focus in terms of, do you stop the running game or do you give up something with that tight end? So they've got problems. And then on top of that, Mike Adams hasn't been that big a factor, but there's a lot of things pulling on Kansas defensively right now.
Pat Fitzgerald has been the main man, wide open. The pass is off the back of number 23, Jason Harris, who comes up limping. Adams had a step on Harris, but the ball, a little wobbly, hit Harris right in the back.
Well, first of all, they're really fortunate that Jason Harris, I mean, I said this last week, you cannot play pass defense without knowing where the ball is. He didn't turn until the very last moment. He has a chance to make a play, to make an interception. Turn away, turn around, make the play. He can make that catch.
If he'd have opened his mouth, he would have swallowed it.
Right, got to make a play.
Third and seven. Sean Mitchell the block by James Brown. Mitchell still dancing around, and he is going to go absolutely nowhere. Tony Blevins doing a good job of just holding position from that free safety spot, along with Maurice Gaddy, who really put the pressure on to begin the play.
Kansas really putting pressure, pursuit. Look at all the flow to the that side of the field. And then when he comes back around, he's coming around him, trying to make a big play, and then just wrapping him up, forcing him up against the sidelines. Good pursuit by the Kansas defense.
On fourth and 15, the Longhorns are going to go for it. Kansas went on a fourth down in the first half, and they were stopped. First time for Texas. Brown, he has the time. The pass tipped incomplete. Jason Thorne from the linebacker spot, the junior from right here in Lawrence, Kansas, got the hand on the pass. Matt Davis, I believe, the intended receiver. Good job defensively for the Kansas Jayhawks.
Kansas has the advantage. They know they've got to go a long distance. They've got to go into the deep or the intermediate part of the zone, and they just step up. And their 20 is playing free safety. Is that 20? Who was that? No, it wasn't Henley. Mo Gaddy, I'm sorry.
Mo Gaddy
playing just really a good job by Kansas.
So Kansas takes over on down. First and 10 from the 29-yard line, and they're going to lose a couple on that play. June Henley, who came into the second half needing just 74 yards rushing the football to tie Tony Sands for the most rushing yards in Kansas career history. But he lost a couple there. What a first half by June Henley. 164 yards rushing, averaged over 6 yards a carry, scored a couple of touchdowns.
And I think for Kansas to win the game, it has to be a great second half by June Henley.
Johnner's pass knocked down. That was the first one they were trying to get to Isaac Byrd. In the first half, Steve, we saw Johnner play action pass rolling out. That was probably one of the first times we saw him with a straight drop.
And the other thing is I don't think he's as spontaneous when he's in that straight drop. I think he falls back into that mechanical, methodical style that Pat Rhule, his offensive coordinator, is very concerned about. When he's out in the corner, he tends to be more active, more agile, and more willing to be instinctive and more as a football player.
Facing third and 13, Johnner drops back, the pass overthrown. Eric Van, the intended receiver. So Texas fails on a fourth and 16, and Kansas fails on a third and 13.
Yeah, but that's a disappointing series for Kansas to start out this, you know, in terms of the second half. They really needed some good things to happen early. You've got the wind at your back. Go make something happen. Reestablish the momentum on that first drive, and they did not do it.
Dean's Mike Adams.
Dean Royal set to kick it away. Mike Adams. Flag, it might be roughing the kicker. This will go for naught. He is dropped at the 25, but we had a penalty flag thrown right at the spot of the punt. I'm not sure if it was running into the kicker or roughing the kicker. It is roughing. Derek Lewis, I believe, is the one shaking his head, and he's the one that will not like to see the film come tomorrow. Look at it one more time and see how it happened.
Number 82, Derek Lewis. What was he doing?
It looked like he tried to stop and then just got underneath his leg.
He really took a path that was accurate, and then he fell in, went into the kicker. I mean, just really lost where he was on the field. I mean, he was in the position initially to make at least a play on a block, but then he just went rolled into the kicker.
That's an oops.
There's another bonus point.
That is exactly right, but can Kansas take advantage of it? They try to go straight up the gut with June Henley carrying the football again. He is going to be one tired guy come tomorrow. He had 25 carries in the first half. And he's added to that total here in quarter number three already with a couple of carries. Both teams holding their own destiny. Texas trying to get into that title game in St. Louis, representing the South. Kansas just trying to get enough wins for a bowl berth.
Henley carries.
Dwight Kirkpatrick puts the hit on Henley.
Josh Half, number 47. Chris Carter, number 16 on the side.
Or maybe vice versa. Henley putting the hit on Kirkpatrick. Henley at 5'11", 215 pounds. Said he would have gone to the NFL had Glenn Mason accepted that Georgia job, taken it, and went to Athens. He said, I probably would have gone ahead and just went to go play on Sundays. But he said when he knew Coach Mason was staying, he knew that he was going to finish out his career. Henley a little high, hurdles over the 50, and he will be close to the first down. And he should have it. Scott Whitaker, that left tackle, the senior out of Alta Loma, California, coming up with a big block. Whitaker was 280 pounds. Now he was 330 when he came to Kansas.
Watch the penetration. You've got to plug holes, but June Henley's able to find a little seam crease, get a little step and jump, and finds the first and 10.
There's Whitaker, didn't even play the first half. They fake the reverse, Johnner keeps it. And the reason he faked the reverse is because Eric Van was going to get hit in the backfield. He saw that the Texas defense, led by Warfield, coming in and covering that play up quickly.
Second and 12.
Trying to make a play or a little razzle dazzle.
I'm not sure if that maybe he was intended.
Maybe he was intended to be. I can't tell from this angle.
From that angle is tough. It looked like he saw the defender on the high shot. Saw him coming in and saw that was spelling doom. Henley breaks one tackle, not able to break the second. Casey Hampton, the true freshman out of Galveston, Texas, who has been given a lot of praise this week by John Makovic when we talked to him. He said he's been able to spell Chris Akins and said, you know, I want to play those two guys together. And now Hampton is limping. He's a big one at 315 pounds. John Makovic telling us this week he likes the position his team is in right now. So you got to think, OU, A&M, and Texas Tech are all in a tougher position than he is. Some of those guys with only one game left. Johnner on 3rd and 10, and a bunch of white jerseys are going to drop him. Texas had only 12 sacks coming into this game. And that is the second sack of the afternoon for the Longhorns. And a timely one. So both offenses that were so powerful in the first half sputtering here in the second. Well, Matt Johnner having some choice words with Glenn Mason. Matt, I'll give you a hint. You're not going to win that argument. Not a good kick into the wind, but it's going to get a great bounce, but it goes into the end zone. A 56-yard kick by Dean Royal. Still tied at 17, 7-10 left in the third. As we take a look at our Nations Bank upcoming schedule, November 29th, circle the calendar. That'll be Texas and Texas A&M hooking it up, and that's going to be a good one. And next week, the Kansas Jayhawks wind up their 96th season by playing at Missouri in a battle of the border. Well, the rain has finally come to Lawrence, Kansas. The umbrellas are coming out. The ponchos are coming out. The wind has really kicked up even more. And it can get real miserable here real quickly. You can't see it on your screen, but it's coming down. And Texas goes upstairs. The pass is complete. A lot of running room. Sean Mitchell up to the 50 in the Kansas territory, all the way down to the 48-yard line before Tony Blevins wrapped him up. A 32-yard pickup by Sean Mitchell.
Texas got what they wanted. Sean Mitchell on Patrick Brown, number 47, the outside linebacker right there. He misses the tackle. That's exactly what kind of matchup they wanted to get, and now it's just a race.
Now with the weather getting bad, every possession becomes extremely important as Williams is tripped up right at the line of scrimmage, maybe picks up about a yard on the play. Brian Nooner, you are covered up, I hope, on the sideline.
Yeah, the rain's not coming down so hard, but it is on the way. You know, we talked about a storm system and we talked about strong winds. That was pretty consistent in the first half. Now it's really getting gusty down here, and you're getting a swirling effect, so I think that's really going to play havoc even more, especially on the passing game coming up here in the second half.
Now, to tell you what a gamer Brian Nooner is, the one game which we have this year that the conditions are going to be miserable, his stage manager's his wife. And we've got a timeout. 6:33 left to play in the third. We're tied up at 17. A baggie, you can't buy those in a store, but you can freeze dry your foot. Second and 8 for Texas. Three-step drop for James Brown. The pass is complete, close to the first down. Mike Adams, the receiver. 23 straight games now with a reception for Adams. He's had 8 100-yard games this year on receiving yards. He is one off the record, and he can get it in that A&M contest.
And he's also probably caused more headaches for defensive coordinators across America than any player.
He's a dandy at 6'1", 185 pounds, and he'll be playing on Sundays. Third and just a yard. Brown didn't get it with the first jump. The second surge may have pushed him across for the first down. Ryan Fiebiger, the center for the Longhorns, the junior out of Flower Mound, Texas, just outside of Dallas. He's the one to try to get the surge going for James Brown. But they're going to have to measure. That's how close it's going to be. There's the big guy, number 58.
Make a surge, make a pile. James Brown follows the biggest rump you can find. Good job.
Chris Jones had the penetration for Kansas. That brings up decision time for that group right there. Fourth down and just a couple of inches.
The way Kansas has come out in the second half, Texas has got to be confident that they can go get a couple of inches here. Sustain the drive, keep the thing going. They need to make something good happen against the wind in the third quarter and take it home in the fourth when they've got the win.
No scoring here in the third quarter so far. 5:36 left to play. Fourth down and a couple of inches, about a half a ball length for Brown. Williams outside, look out. That's what happens when you put that many men on the line of scrimmage at times and you get a good block.
Tony Blevins, number 28, with the stop, first down.
15 yards on the carry by Williams.
Kansas really anticipated with the two linebackers an inside play, and he just found the outside seam, and there, once again, leading the charge, Pat Fitzgerald, the tight end, who's not only been a top receiver today, but he has made several key blocks.
Williams again bangs his way down to the 15-yard line. Pickup of 8 on the play.
The offensive line, watch Ben Adams. He's pulling right there. There he is. There's Ben. He's going to open it up and create that little seam, that little crease that these Texas backs have been very solidly capable of finding every play today.
That giggle by Steve Davis was the fact we almost got blown out of our booth. Second and 2. James Brown, great ball fake. He's got the blockers. He's got some room. Somebody's excited down on the sideline. What a ball fake, though, by James Brown. And an excellent call by the coaching staff of the Longhorns.
Phil Dawson, number 4, to try the
extra. Dawson will kick the extra point. The first score of the second half, and it comes with 4:23 left in the third. Dawson gives the Longhorns a 7-point lead. 24-17 is our score. With 4:23 left to play in the third, Big 12 football will return after these local messages. First here in the second half, they lead at 24-17, 4:23 to go, and Kansas will begin first and 10 from their own 31-yard line. After the kick was a short kick, which we were unable to show you. We were still in the commercial break. Texas, it was a fair catch, though.
Texas wanted to pick up the tempo.
Henley lowers the head. Let's take a look at the fake by James Brown for the score.
Well, a couple of things. The fake by James Brown to Ricky Williams, number 11, that's part of the play. The other thing is that Kansas defense is in man coverage. The receivers had taken them into the end zone, and then they'd really turned their back on James Brown, and that's how James Brown then at the 1 yard line stuffs it in on a physical play to get it in the end zone.
Jamie Harris couldn't make the stop. Ronnie Ward overran it. Henley looking for some blocks. He's going to be tripped up behind the line of scrimmage. Chris Carter came up from the free safety spot to really make that play. And then everybody else, including Kyle Richardson, number 59, the junior from Richardson, Texas, came up to make the stop. 7 plays, 80 yards. Again, Texas putting together an 80-yard drive. They've done that a couple of times this afternoon. They have been impressive on those drives. Of course, the big play was the fourth down and a half an inch when Williams takes it 15 yards. Johnner rolls, cocks the rifle, and is tipped incomplete. Aaron Humphrey, the true freshman from Lubbock, Texas, is the one who got a piece of it. That is his sixth pass he has knocked down this year.
And really what Texas is getting accomplished is a solid pass rush, not a great one, but good job. There's Dusty Renfro on a blitz from the linebacker position, but the cornerbacks and safeties are doing such a great job defending against the pass on these receivers. They have nobody to throw to.
Right. Dean Royal had a 56-yarder his first kick, and he's going to get a one taken at the 20-yard line. Six-yard kick for Royal, and Texas takes over. Ball on the 28-yard line. Well, next week, the Big 12 game of the week will be in Columbia, Missouri for a border battle between the Kansas Jayhawks and the Missouri Tigers. Now, this rivalry dates back to 1891. Join us Saturday morning at 11:30 Central on most of these Big 12 stations. Steve will be joined by Drew Goodman on that play. This is my final telecast. I got a second. Thanking Kevin Landy, Patrick McClanahan of Fox for allowing us to be part of this year. Steve, and for the guy that makes us look good every week, Sammy Polis, up in the booth with us. Thank you, gentlemen. And Bob Steinfeld, Kenny Miller in the truck, Eric Josephson, thank you, guys. I can't say thanks to Bob Steinfeld. I got to do a whole basketball season with him. I'll wait till the end of the year.
On the offense, still first down.
That was against Texas. It'll push him back. For you Kansas fans, you might remember last week against Kansas State, Jayhawks trailed by just 2 in intermission, but they didn't score at all in the second half. And they went on to lose that ball game to Kansas State, 38-12. Brown needed to hit the cutoff man to get it to Ricky Williams. That'll bring up a 2nd and 15. Ball on the 23-yard line.
Kansas has shown all afternoon a willingness to put 8, 9, sometimes 10 people up in the box area, the penetration area. But what's happened is that Texas can take them out of it because they can find the tight end or get a back out of the backfield, and that's really kind of thwarted Kansas' ability to put all that pressure on trying to stop the run.
Only one safety back for Kansas, and Texas keeps it on the ground. And there you saw how many men were in the box on that play, anticipating the run by Sean Mitchell. Brett McGraw from that nose tackle spot, the junior from Garden City, Kansas, in on the stop.
Kansas has done a really good job of being able to
maintain a pretty good pressure defense up in the front. The problem is these backs have been able to find seams or creases where the quarterback's been able to find the tight end, and that's caused the problem for them.
Texas is only 4 of 9 on third down. They're facing 3rd and 13. The rush. Texas keeps it on the ground, and they're not going to get it. Ricky Williams able to get up to about the original line of scrimmage, which was the 28-yard line. Chris Jones, number 49, the junior out of Newton, Kansas, on the stop.
4th and 10.
Mark Schultes set to kick it away. This is only his second punt of the afternoon. Isaac Byrd back to receive it for Kansas. Byrd had that 94-yard return versus Oklahoma earlier. Short kick. They get a little bit of a roll into the wind. Only a 29-yard kick in Kansas with excellent field position with 1:17 left in the third. As we take a look at our Dr. Pepper scoreboard, good battle going on in Ann Arbor. Clemson leading North Carolina State in the third. Temple up by a touchdown over BC. And South Carolina trying to make a game of it. Tennessee and Arkansas, not enough. Iowa leading Wisconsin. Notre Dame by a touchdown. The word, Lou Holtz, is he going to retire at the end of the season? Bill Curry says he's going to leave at the end of the year, and Kentucky gets on a roll. And Southwest Louisiana will be taking on Texas Tech later. One other score in the first. Missouri and Baylor scoreless. Sanders, the ball carrier. Well, June Henley has been extremely quiet here in quarter number three after that robust performance in the first 30 minutes. But it seems like the Texas defense just stacking things up in the middle now, and Henley not getting any running room. This time they don't buy the play action. The pass is complete. Just for Johnner to get that away to Jim Moore, who gets his second reception, was a pretty decent effort by that young man. Dwight Kirkpatrick is the one putting the pressure on Johnner.
Let me see if I can watch Tyson King on June Henley. Henley, the play is going to go away from him, but maybe why Henley's struggling is because they're marrying each other. That's one of the ways to stop June Henley. Put a linebacker on him and mirror him to make sure that you keep him out of trouble.
Henley has had his best success between the tackles.
Tackled by 97, Warfield.
That time, he picks up a couple of yards. Brian, it looks like the rain has subsided somewhat, a light sprinkle, but the wind's still kicking up down there. How is it?
Well, you're absolutely right about the rain. It has subsided. I really can't feel it at all. However, the wind is still there, going back to that gusting effect. It's still gusting around. It's a little inconsistent, but when it does kick up, it's definitely a problem.
We have completed three quarters of play in Lawrence, Kansas. Only one touchdown in that third quarter. That gave the Longhorns a 7-point advantage. Fourth quarter still to come. 24-17 is our score as we head to the final 15 minutes of play here in Lawrence, Kansas. And the key play in that third quarter was a fourth down and about a foot. Texas went for it. Ricky Williams on the carry, picked up 15 yards, and that set up the touchdown by James Brown.
James Brown really showed tremendous ability to get into the end zone. I mean, physical, right there at about the 2-yard line, drives, twist, finds the end zone.
This is the fourth time in 5 games that Texas has been on the road. The previous 3 games on the road, they just went 1-2. Sanders on the carry.
In the fourth quarter, against the wind, somebody's got to step up for Kansas, either offensively or defensively, and make a big play. June Henley has done his part to get them to this point, to a close ball game in the fourth quarter. Now Matt Johnner, somebody has got to make some plays for Kansas to give them a chance to win the ball game.
It's a big one here. Third down and a yard. 2 tight ends in, 2 wide receivers to the right. And when you need a yard, you give it to the big gun, June Henley. Tripped up as he crosses the 30 by Dusty Renfro and Trey Thomas. But that's good enough for a first down, and the drive continues for Kansas, and the rain coming down again. Glenn Mason strolling on the sidelines, trying to get something going offensively. Johnner is going to be dropped. Tyson King is the one who came in and made the stop. Second and 14 now for the Jayhawks. Ball's on the 33-yard line. Well, Texas was biting on that play-action fake in the first half. They haven't been on it here in quarter number threes and four. Henley, left side, got some running room. Chris Carter finally shoving him out of bounds. He will be short of the first down. It'll bring up a third down play for Kansas.
June Henley continues to really be a tough physical runner today. Texas did a good job. Chris Carter is chasing him. But again, he continues to make plays in that running back position. Somebody else has got to help him, though.
Well, the second half, at times, Texas has gone to a 4-3 defense. Now they put eight men in the box on third down and four, and Kansas is not going to get it. When needed, that defensive front line of Texas has stood up to the challenge.
Well, and two, Tyson King and Dusty Renfro, those two linebackers in the middle, were able to plug the holes. They were aggressive, they penetrated, and they made the play to force the fourth down.
And it is fourth and five, and Kansas is going to go for it. Akins comes out of the lineup. Inside of 13 minutes here in the fourth. Kansas hoping to keep their bowl hopes alive. Johnner, Texas has it covered well, and he has to throw it away. What a job by the Texas defensive line again. Aaron Humphrey, the true freshman, is the one who really started to put the pressure on Johnner, forcing him out of the pocket.
Well, two things happen. First, they get tenacious effort out of that line. They don't have but a three-man rush, because you've got to drop in. You've got everybody really just putting pressure on him. But what made it happen, the linebackers and the secondary had covered up all the receivers. He had nowhere to go.
There's Will Goodloe, the true freshman out of Spring Valley, California. He also putting pressure on Johnner, and Texas takes over on downs, leading by a touchdown.
Goodloe's played more because Casey Hampton has been hurt, has had that tender ankle today.
Ricky Williams slipping tackles, bouncing to the outside, takes a hard fall. Williams, who spends the springs in the Philadelphia Phillies organization. He's got the Rastafarian dreadlocks working, likes reggae music. Well, up in the booth right now, and he's got his raincoat on. He's ready to go. He knows how windy it is up here. He's the commissioner of the Big 12 Conference, and we're glad to have him, a friend of Steve's and mine for a number of years, Steve Hatchell. Steve, good to have you here.
Good to be here, Ron. Nice to be with you and Steve.
It's dry up here, too.
Yes, it is. It's not that less windy here, though. This is a tough day to play football.
A great game, though, Steve.
It's a terrific game. Both have so much to play for here, and you can see it just in the intensity of this game.
Steve, you talk about how much there is to play for. We saw a graphic a while ago about how many teams are trying to fight for a possible bowl bid. Obviously, John Makovic wanting to win the South. Is this about what you thought it would be, as intense and people knocking each other all over the place?
Absolutely. And I think that when we started the season, that there were several ways that people analyzed the year. One, we had seven teams that were ranked last year in the top 25. Then when you break it all down into the two divisions, everybody knew that once we got into the north-south type of rivalries, that this was going to be extremely intense. And I think you look at all of our games today, it's a great example of that.
Third and nine for the Longhorns. Kansas needs a stop. Brown's got some running room. He has the first down and then some. Good job by Brown. And, you know, one of the there's good and bad about having such a great conference. The bad is some media like to take pot shots at the beginning of the year. What's your answer to them that said, hey, you know, the Big 12, look, they got all these powerhouses, and they didn't do that well non-conference?
I think that, one, there were such great expectations, first of all, and I think some of those, frankly, were a little bit too high. Secondly, as you see what's happened across the country in the last couple of weeks, we're now into a situation in college football where you have to play the entire year. We got off to a slow start, yes, in some non-conference games, but when you see Memphis beat Tennessee, when you see Purdue beat Michigan, and you see some other upsets, it clearly indicates that you have to wait to go through this whole year. We would love to have six or seven teams ranked in the top 25 right now, but frankly, with the strength of this conference, and I think with it being so new, being divided into divisions and playing eight conference games, not just seven, which is very, very significant, I think that we are in remarkably wonderful condition.
How are things going and getting ready for the championship game? I know that's going to be exciting.
It will be exciting. December 7th in St. Louis. The St. Louis people have done a marvelous job.
What a great facility.
Oh, it's a great facility, and I think it'll be a real, be an outstanding showcase for Big 12 football.
On second and eight for the Longhorns, they lead it by a touchdown. Ball is loose, down on the ground. Everybody going after it. Let's see who they give it to. I think Texas wrapped it back up. And are there tickets available for the championship game?
For the most part, we have a few tickets left through the St. Louis ticket office. Tickets, for the most part, are sold out. Each team that will qualify will be provided 7,500 tickets for their fans, and hopefully that'll be enough. But we think that in this first year that, for all intents and purposes, it will be sold out, and the enthusiasm is now beginning to build as people see what a championship game is, and it's beginning to sink in. It'll be a lot of fun.
It's going to be a dandy December 7th. Third and seven for the Longhorns. One lone setback. Ricky Williams trying to get the first down, reaches across the 45. And he will be about 4 yards short. Steve, we know that you started late. I mean, people don't realize what it's like starting a conference. And really, you didn't come into play until July, but you have done a marvelous job, and Steve and I are extremely proud to be part of it.
Well, we've had the benefit of a lot of things. One, the commitment by our chief executive officers and all of our institutions to make the Big 12 as good as we can be. We started July 1st, and at that point, then we hired our staff. We've had the terrific support of all of our athletic directors that we meet every month to go through all of the issues that have to be dealt with. And I think as a result, because of the commitment by our institutions and all of our people, we're in remarkably good shape. The other thing that goes with that is that it's not just a matter of us starting a new conference. We got so many other issues to be dealt with on a national scale that we had to get up to speed in a hurry.
Well, Steve, best of luck. Thanks for stopping by in the booth. Steve Hatchell, commissioner of the Big 12 Conference. We'll step aside, 9:21 to play. The Longhorns by a touchdown. We'll be back. Lawrence, Kansas, and the Longhorns still with their eyes set on that Southern Division title, looking for a victory today. Lead it by a touchdown. Kansas with the ball, first and 10. It's on the 21. The outside possibility of a bowl game. Texas putting everybody up on the line, and they stuffed Jew Henley. The Southwest Airlines storyline looks like this for today. Ricky Williams, 151 yards rushing the football. Henley, 194 rushing. Texas has had the best success going right into the teeth of the wind.
Yeah, and that 30 yards in the second half by Henley is mainly because the linebackers, Dusty Renfro and Tyson King, have been really more of a factor in the second half. They're plugging holes. They're being more involved in the penetration of the game. That's why he's struggling here in the second half.
From the shotgun, they give it to Henley, and he's going to lose a couple of yards. And the fans don't like it. But you have to give credit to Casey Hampton right in the middle there of that Texas line. But still, you have to wonder, Steve, when is Isaac Byrd going to make a catch? He has been extremely quiet. They wanted to get him the ball, not getting it to him.
Watch that front. Watch the linebackers just fill holes right there. That's 46, Dusty Renfro, sorry. Right there's Dusty Renfro filling the hole. They've been more aggressive in plugging it for the University of Texas.
There's Isaac Byrd, no catches in the ball game, facing third and 12. Henley in motion. Johnner feels the pressure. Scrambling, not a whole lot of running room. He ran out of real estate. Aaron Humphrey, the true freshman from Lubbock, just tracked him down along with Kirkpatrick.
Ron, remember what we said in the pregame about who had to play big?
That's right.
The quarterbacks, the offensive line, and the secondary. And I think the key has been this Texas secondary has just smothered the receivers for the University of Kansas. Matt Johnner didn't have anybody to throw to.
Nobody. Damon Luckett was tracing him out of the pocket, so he didn't have any place to go to.
It's not Matt Johnner's fault.
Not a bit. That's one of those coverage sacks.
Oh, boy.
That kick into the teeth of the wind did absolutely nothing.
Ball is down at the 39.
That was about a 17-yard kick for Royal. And that hurts. 7:17 to play in a ball game. Texas now has everything going their way. We'll be back after our word from Sonic Drive-In, where we invite you to drive in for a change. We expected rain at the beginning, and it's coming with all the fury right about now. 24-17 is our score. 7:17 left to play in a ball game. A very brave Brian Nooner on the sidelines. Steve and I up in the booth, and we are glad you can be with us today. This has been a good football game. Texas with the lead in the ball. Ricky Williams with a stiff arm. Look at the punishment. He lost his shoe, and he still keeps plugging away. Ricky Williams blew a tire about 10 yards back. Ronnie Ward is the one that yanked it off. That's going to feel real good putting that shoe on a wet sock. He's not even going to tie it up. He's so tough, he's not even going to tie it again.
Watch everybody pull. You've seen all that action. I mean, this is the, if you're Kansas, this is a scary play. A lot of these defensive players, when I talked to them yesterday, they were saying this Texas offense can be scary. That's the scary part when you see Dan Neal and Feeberger, some of these guys pulling on you. That's a scary play.
He likes being called Little Earl. He would like to break the Big Earls, all his rushing records at UT. He is a good one. And I think the decision for that young man, is he going to be Bo Jackson and try to do two sports or stick to one? The baseball people tell us he should stick with baseball. Football people tell us he should stick with football. He's blessed. Second and seven for Texas. 6.5 to play in a ball game. They lead by 7. They are in no hurry. Williams tripped up. Maybe got a yard.
And on the punt that Kansas had to give the ball to Texas, that was really the first time we've seen the wind really bite back. Kansas offense was unable to move the ball. They had a short punt because of the wind. Texas is in a position to put the game, you know, out of reach for Kansas.
There's Mike Hankowitz, defensive coordinator at Kansas, was defensive coordinator at Colorado for a number of years.
Defensively, they've done a great job. Actually, both sides of the ball, they've done a great job against Texas today.
Third and 5 for the Longhorns. Brown, great ball fake. Touchdown, UT. Once again, it was the James Brown ball fake that set everything else up. And Ricky Williams gets the touchdown from 7 yards out. Good call again by that Texas coaching staff. Dawson on to attempt the extra point. This is insurance. Right down the middle. 5:42 to play in the ball game. The dreadlocks have done it today. Wonder Williams has given Texas a 14-point advantage. Has given Texas the 14-point advantage, 31-17. Shades of last week for Kansas. 5:42 left to play in the ball game. But Steve, during the commercial, you and I were talking. You take away the last Kansas drive, the bad punt, and it's still only a 7-point game.
That's right. That's the small difference that this game was going to be really played off of, and that's exactly what happened because they didn't get the punt, they didn't get the drive, couldn't sustain anything, and Texas took advantage of it.
Almost got on the track.
Ricky Williams is right here, and he's going to do this, and no one picks him up for Kansas. Watch what happens. Great fake by James Brown. Had Williams switch, but that's it. There William is. at Sean Mitchell Circle is on the other side. He went inside in the flat, and he has played one great football game.
And on that last drive, he had a 27-yard run, a 7-yard TD reception. That's a couple of games in a row. He's our Dr. Pepper player of the game, Ricky Williams. That's two excellent games. Last week against Tech, this week against Kansas. First and 10 for the Jayhawks, 5:42, as the crowd is really thinning out now. What a hit. Henley is stacked up by Aaron Humphrey. And you can hear it up here. Kirkpatrick helps out. Humphrey there to lower the boom. Second and nine.
The adjustment that Texas made in the inside with their linebackers Renfro and King literally shut off June Henley in the second half. He was running wild in the first half. Makovic said they're going to make some adjustments. They were able to get more penetration. They mirrored him. They took him out of the game in the second half.
Every yard he has gotten in the second half have been tough yards like that. Well, the expectations, as Glenn Mason said, from the media coming into this season for these Kansas Jayhawks were huge. But he said that the expectations obviously have changed a lot in 9 years. But they have to remember where they came from. And it's beginning, I think, to lightning and thunder. And we're about 10 stories up. You go to church tomorrow, Steve?
Every Sunday.
Yeah, here you go. Johnner is crushed. As soon as Matt Johnner released it, Kyle Richardson lowered the boom at him. What a hit by 59.
And he's that weak side linebacker, 59. Tyson King is the starter. He's the number two man and just takes it out. Johnner has not had an open receiver in the second half. Great pressure by the linebackers in the front. Wonderful coverage by the secondary.
And on fourth and seven, Kansas is just going to kick it away. And boy, we had some big, big lightning. I think the officials may have to make a decision here. This could get real dangerous. And this kick goes 30 yards and then comes back about 20.
Wow.
That ball got halfway up to the 50, and then the wind blew it back to the 40 where it hit. A 7-yard kick. And we're going to keep it right here. But Dean Royal did about everything he could. This is a big-time win. It is raining extremely hard. It is beginning to lightning and thunder. And they just want the clock to run out right now with 4:08 left. These fans should at least get Roy Williams' autograph, the Kansas basketball coach, for sitting through this. Now the rain is just coming down in droves. You can barely see out there. And for our camera guys down there, we appreciate your effort. Ricky Williams turns the corner. My goodness, it's coming down. That's just part of it. These are some sick individuals. Hey, Mom, send me to college. I want to put a T on my bare chest and stand out in a rainstorm.
They love those horns.
Yeah, that umbrella's really working, isn't it? Look at that. Williams needs only 10 more yards for 200 yards rushing. The handoff tripped up at about the 20-yard line. This is the ultimate conehead here. One of the cheerleaders.
Whoa.
I don't know how much farther back in the booth you and I can get. This is about as far as our
court
goes.
There may be something about Texas and heavy rain. Yeah. Remember the Missouri game earlier?
That's right. And they had to stop that game because of lightning. We're sending Lapham and Goodman next time it starts raining. Those two guys get to come. 3:35 to play. Texas with a 14-point advantage, and they're going to keep it on the ground, and they got a lot of running room. Making his way all the way down to the 1-yard line. Number 27, Chris Butcher, the redshirt freshman out of Longview, Texas.
All Texas backs have had in the second half
wonderful execution on this play. They're getting good penetration by the offensive line, and they've been able to find seams.
18-yard pickup by Butcher. He's an accomplished musician. He is a jazz pianist. Touchdown, Texas. Priest Holmes goes over the top for his second rushing touchdown of the afternoon. His eighth on the season. And this one is going to be in the books. Once again, a bad punt has led to a Texas touchdown. Second in a row.
A punt very badly influenced by severe wind.
Oh, yeah. Dawson for the extra point. And it is good. 3 minutes and 11 seconds left to be played in the ball game, and the Longhorns have opened up a 21-point lead at 38-17. In case you just joined us, we were tied at 17 at halftime. It was an exciting first 30 minutes of play as June Henley, Ricky Williams, Sean Mitchell put on a running performance. Second half all UT.
As you look, there's not a blue jersey standing up. That Texas offensive line had literally crushed that defensive front of Kansas. There was no one standing up, being tall and causing keeping the running back Priest Holmes out of the end zone. Wonderful job by the Texas offensive line.
They have done a great job here in the second half, opening up that 21-point advantage. Texas now will set their sights on the game against A&M. A&M could play the role of a major league spoiler.
But the band is still playing.
The band is still playing. They haven't given up. I don't think the Longhorn band. Yeah, the Longhorn band's here too. We will have a name the attendance contest when this is over. Well, due to the bad weather, you can imagine we're having some difficulties with our satellite feed and our signal, and we do apologize, but out of our hands here today.
First and 10 at the 20.
The South standings of the Big 12 Conference coming into today were interesting. A number of teams still mathematically with a position to possibly win it. But it was Texas on top, 4-2, a half a game lead over Tech. Barring some unforeseen miracle, Texas will go to 5-2. They will truly be in the driver's seat. And now John Makovic, who told us earlier this week, this team has to finish strong. We got to gear it up. He liked his position. Their destiny was in their own hands, and they're taking advantage of it. Henley wrapped up behind the line of scrimmage. John Makovic's wife on the field. Arlene, we need to introduce her to Brian Nooner's wife. These two are troopers for being out there. Now we understand Brian went in the truck, huh? Boy, he pulled the old ripcord on that one, didn't he?
Oh, he can't be in the truck.
I'd dock him 2 minutes and 42 seconds of salary myself. Inside of 235, Kansas did not get the ball to Isaac Byrd once in this football game. And when June Henley was stuffed, their only other option was Byrd, and they couldn't get it to him.
Well, and remember what Colorado did to Kansas. They did the same number on Isaac Byrd. They literally kept him. I can't remember if he had some catches in the game, but they did a wonderful job of keeping him out of the ball game, and then they put the ball game in someone else's hands. The wind kept Johnner out of the game in the passing game. They said, okay, we can manage. We've got the receivers covered, the quarterback covered. June Henley can run for his 204 yards, and that's what's happened today.
Saw the numbers on Henley. He has had a wonderful career here at Kansas, and he still has one game to go. He can set even more records against Missouri next week. And, of course, you can see that game, 11:30 Central, on most of these same stations. Check your local listings. Join Steve, Drew Goodman, Brian Nooner for the Kansas-Missouri game coming your way next Saturday. Fifth career 200-yard game for June Henley. Now, coverage of today's game and produced by Robert Steinfeld, directed by Ken Miller. Our TD as usual, Richard Harlan, our associate director, Tom Stoner, associate producer, Eric Josephson. Production operations down in Houston, Tammy Rippey and Judy Jackson. Happy birthday, Judy Jackson. Director of Productions, Kevin Landy, and our executive producer is Patrick McClanahan. Thank you, gentlemen, for a wonderful year as far as I'm concerned. Of course, next week we still have one more game left, but it has been a ball the past 10 weeks.
Well, June Henley has played his heart out today. He has done everything he could to do his part.
Second down and six inside of 1 minute. Henley dives forward and maybe picked up a yard. Brian Nooner has made his way out of the truck. I don't know why. Brian, why did you leave? Thanks, bro.
Well, you can see my umbrella is a victim to the weather conditions. You know, one time I got this thing working like this, and I was doing the old Morton Salt Girl impersonation, but the wind's just too strong. It's playing havoc down here. So you can imagine how difficult it is to punt, and we've seen the effect the last two times Kansas has punted into the wind.
All right. Weatherman. He gets an A for effort today, though. Did a nice job. Thank you, Brad. Henley left side on third and five, and that's going to do it, folks. It was the June Henley show in the first half, but the second half, it was the Texas show. Their defense stood up to the challenge. Their offense came alive. And the Longhorns are in the driver's seat for that Southern Division title. They have their eyes set on St. Louis and, of course, the Texas A&M game. That is the big star, number 11, Ricky Williams. A couple of touchdowns. He did everything that we had expected him to do. And I think, Steve, this is a great confidence builder for this UT team. They had the big one last week. They've won consecutive games, and they had a third now. This team is gathering momentum. This is when you want to do it.
Yeah, that's right. You're making a run for the championship. You're going to, you know, have one more game, and you're in the championship against who comes out of the Northern Division. And certainly Texas is playing much better as a team. And they really accomplished a lot today as a team, playing much better. John Makovic should be happy.
To the strains of the eyes of Texas, the UT players facing the Texas band, giving the familiar sign. Win for UT, 38-17 is the final score over the Jayhawks of Kansas. And John Makovic is with Brian Nooner now. Brian?
Well, Coach, appreciate you standing. It's a hell of a play for this game, but you came through with a big victory.
Absolutely. It's a big part of it. And didn't know when the rain was coming, but we played hard in the third quarter. I thought that was the difference. We took the ball, gave them the win, and we felt that in a tight game we wanted to win the fourth quarter, but we began to take control in the third.
It isn't often a running back can rush for more than 200 yards and come out on the losing end in a dominant game, but that was a case. June Henley had the best efforts, but at the same time, your running game was very effective too.
Now, we've been strong running the ball. We mix it about a little more than other people. We give it to several different players. I'm real proud of the way our team has played offensively. Our defense in the second half was the difference, though. We really rose up and stopped them.
Yeah, you stopped the run. John, you've improved your position to represent the South in the Big 12 championship game, but still a big game waits ahead.
Now, 2 weeks. We've got one big one to go, and we'll look forward to it. But this one really means a lot to us. It gives us a lot of stepping stones to other things.
All right. Thanks a lot for joining us. Good drive. Thank you.
All right. 38-17 is our final score. And we apologize for the audio problems. It's difficult down on the field. Texas wins it. They beat the Jayhawks. We'll be back right after this word from Dr. Pepper. And it's 85 Dr. Pepper bottlers. Happy to bring you this inaugural season of Big 12 football.